Welcome to Today Matters, our short devotional in the Word of God. We've been traveling through the book of 1 Peter, and lately we've been looking at why we should be unselfish. And in my next few devotionals with you, we're going to be looking closer at 1 Peter 3:8 through 14, which says this: "Finally, all of you, be like-minded, be sympathetic, love one another, be compassionate and humble. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult. On the contrary, repay evil with blessing, because to this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing." I wonder if that would change anything in our world these days if we followed what God's word said there. And then he goes on, "Whoever would love life and see good days must keep their tongue from evil and their lips from deceitful speech." Now that seems like a prophecy from AD 64 to stay off of social media in 2020. I mean, have you noticed how brave people are on social media? They have fake names and accounts and they just blast off on people with no accountability. And Peter continues. He says, "They must turn from evil and do good. They must seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous and his ears are attentive to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil." And then 1 Peter 3:13 and 14 goes on. He says, "Who is going to harm you if you're eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened." You know, one of the things you see when you look around creation is that God loves diversity. We're all different. None of us are alike. God could have made us all alike, but he didn't. I've said it before, if you think only one race is going to be in heaven, that's a sure sign you're not going to be there. Because God loves diversity, and heaven will be very diverse. But also, it's interesting to me that the opposites often marry each other, right? In all the years I've done marriage counseling, it's funny how the pattern is repeated. Before you got married, all you could see was how much you had in common with that person. After you got married, it's a whole different story. All you could see was how much you don't have in common with that person. They say that opposites attract, but after marriage, opposites attack. All those things you thought were so cute when you were dating really get on your nerves now. Now, I'm going to give you some keys that diffuse conflict bombs, okay? I'm going to show you the igniters, and I'm going to show you the diffusers. You can choose to throw gasoline on a fire, or you can throw water on it. We tell our staff all the time, you carry around two buckets with you when it comes to gossip and division in the church. On one hand, you have a bucket of gas. In the other hand, you have a bucket of water. When a potential conflict sparks up, you can either throw the bucket of gas on it, or you can put it out by throwing a bucket of water on it. It's your choice. Every time. So let's take a look at some of the diffusers and the igniters of these conflict tents, these bombs. This is for any relationship, whether you're married or not. This is for your friends, your coworkers, your neighbors, your boss, your employer, your employees, your employer. God says, "I made you differently, but I want you to get along." In verse 8, it says, "Live in harmony with each other." Fortunately, Peter tells us exactly how to do that. He gives us six ingredients. Six attitudes. He says, if you build these into your life, you're going to find that the conflict in your relationships are dramatically reduced. If you live around people for any length of time, you're going to have conflicts. Peter says, if you'll just build these six attitudes into your life, you will find dramatic improvement in your relationships. Whether it's with your husband, with your wife, with your children, your parents, your employers, your employees, friends, neighbors, those who are different than you, all of them. He says, do these things to reduce or even eliminate the conflict in your life. And I can tell you this, our communities can use this these days. So here's the diffuser if you're taking notes. Sympathy. Sympathy. In verse 8, it says, be sympathetic. If you want to ignite the conflict, don't listen to other people. Don't listen. What does it mean to be sympathetic? To sympathize simply means to understand and validate or affirm someone's feelings. Not necessarily their ideas, their feelings. When you're sensitive to their feelings, you don't belittle them. You don't put them down. You don't say, you shouldn't feel that way. When you validate somebody else's feelings, you're being sympathetic. Sympathy does two things. It meets two basic human needs. Number one, all of us have a need to be understood. You want somebody to understand you in life. And number two, all of us have a need to feel like our feelings are okay. We want somebody to validate them. Am I just nuts? Am I weird? Does anybody else feel this way? And when you find somebody who is sympathetic with you, it not only says, I understand, but it says, I validate your feelings. I may not feel the way you feel, but I'm validating the fact that you feel that way. It's not a matter of right or wrong at that point. It doesn't mean you snow them over either. If what they're feeling is completely irrational, it's not like you don't have a conversation. You know, they're paranoid, the world's against me, it might be some irrational medical condition they think they have, whatever it is, you'd speak truth to them. But I want to close with this. Peter says that the first building block, the first step in diffusing conflict, it's key. Understand where people are coming from. Understand their background. Understand their temperament. Understand the circumstances that have shaped them. See, when you do that, not only will they allow you to speak into their life and even speak more truth perhaps into their life, but when you're doing that, you're learning to be sympathetic.